We all have been talking about wearables, biosensors, and continuous monitoring for some time. And we know with the cost of healthcare going through the roof, there is really room for these type of technologies. What I'd like to also present tonight is that besides the challenges of the healthcare system, there are three other things that are at play, which makes 2018 a very exciting year for this sort of technology. One is acceptance by patients and consumers. Secondly, the technology is here. But the third and the most important thing that is unique to 2018 is the clinical evidence. We now are starting to have clinical evidence, and as we speak, I know a number of prestigious journals that are reviewing this type of data for publication, and leading institutions are using these, starting to use these products in their hospitals and healthcare systems. We all know that nobody wants to be the first for a new technology, but as our chief medical officer reminds me, nobody also wants to be the last. So the trend is there, the clinical evidence is here, and with all those other underpinnings of the cost of healthcare, the technology, and also the need that is seen by the patient community, I think this is going to be an exciting year for all of us. So I'm going to start with the first of the concepts that I talked about, is that really the acceptance is there by everyone to be continuously connected. So as we know, socially, everybody is connected. And if you have teenager children, you know they're more than connected. They're always connected. On finances, banking, on purchasing stocks, and all of those type of activities. Payments, again, everybody is continuously connected. And then even parenting, you know, having virtual boundaries for your children, looking after them, and so forth. So this concept is becoming widely used and accepted, and I could also extend to alerts for remote control of your house and lights and all of those type of conveniences. Then moving to the temperature in your house, energy saving, and that sort of activities, plus monitoring your house by utility companies. It's all there. Nobody seems to be upset about these anymore, and at the same time, they're enjoying the convenience and the cost savings. In the healthcare market, also the wellness, the unregulated part, the health and wellness part has also enjoyed a number of acceptances in the market. So for example, in fitness, how many steps you took, your exercise and calorie burn, a whole bunch of applications in that area. On consumption of food, and as you know, there are some that even try to estimate the number of calories you're consuming by taking a picture of what you're eating. So again, more health and wellness applications. And if you live in California, maybe in East Coast as well, there is also applications for your pets. So for example, you want to make sure your dog took the appropriate number of steps and walked the right amount of time. And if you're not the one who's walking the dog, you want to make sure you're a person who did that, did the enough number of miles or steps for your dog. So that's sort of starting with the fact that everybody wants to this sort of monitoring, and again, moving it to the healthcare side. Statistics are also revealing on the both on the wearable and for medical apps. And again, that's an area that you see almost a tripling in a matter of just a few years. So we're accepting these type of monitoring, and we're moving it to the healthcare, first to the wellness area, and we're seeing rapid growth. So I want to now expand that to the medical side, which is what we concern most in this audience. What do we do right now? The continuous monitoring of vital signs has been around for a few decades. And we know if anybody is in ICU, essentially their life depends on it. So it has been done. But obviously, that is a type of technology that you cannot extend because of cost, and not just cost, the complexity of device. They have to be operated by very skilled technicians, and the data to be interpreted by doctors. Then, as far as the monitoring is concerned, when patient is released to the general ward, again, those type of equipments are too expensive to move, so what do? We do the spot check. But when we do spotting checks, a good number of times, 96, 97% of the time, the patient is not monitored. So if there is a technology that can do that, obviously the hospitals would look at it favorably because they know if somebody was sick, they wanted to do it 100% of the time if somebody was really sick. And then, as you know, when patient gets discharged, you essentially get a phone call, and that's about as much as most most people get, and ask you to maybe come for a checkup in a week. So this is what we're dealing with maybe right now, but again, if the technology that is sort of ICU grade, but it's inexpensive, convenient to use, obviously for a good portion of patients, we could have extended to general ward and also to home use after discharge. And obviously, on the price point of view, that first is super expensive, takes a lot of time for nurses to visit in their rooms, and the phone call is very inexpensive, but also very ineffective. How do we get this thing outside the ICU? Let me just show some statistics really quick. You all know familiar with that. We have a lot of hospitals. The average stay is about 5 days, and staying in a hotel, in a hospital is like a super expensive hotel. So these are the stats that we're familiar with, and obviously we want to do something about them. But I pass through these quickly to get to the part that I think is the more exciting part. Again, a lot of expenses in readmissions, and also in Medicare costs, which has ramification in public policy, taxes that need to be paid to pay for those and so forth. The economic part, as I said, has been well known, and I want to spend more time on why this year all of those have been around, the clinical evidence that helps us move along to solve some of these problems. Essentially, what we're trying to do is to keep the patients out of hospital. And I will show you some data on a leading hospital system that has gone beyond monitoring the patients after their ICU or the surgical procedure. They're trying to actually admit some of the patients right off the bat to their homes. And there is very, very promising results by that institution. And obviously, we want to keep the patients healthy at home. And how do we know they're healthy if we did not take measurements? And obviously, continuous monitoring is helpful for that. Deterioration, that is the cause of all these readmissions, and possibly worse. If we could know that the patient is deteriorating, we could do what is possible to avoid that. Obviously, we want to have a more preventive healthcare system. Finally, on the clerical burden, once the data is continuous and electronic, you can always find the interface to put it in your EMR or EHR. So that's also an additional advantage. So let's see how we can do that. Now, again, I go through these very quickly. You know, the cost is extremely high, population is aging, and continuous monitoring is the solution that we're going to deploy to look after these costly situations. Now, what are the statistics? Has the continuous monitoring been shown to be useful? Before we had the technologies that are very cost effective, people have done quite a bit of analysis on the patients and how they could be helped. For example, on the number of people who have preventable adverse events annually, and this just in the United States, are over 400,000. So obviously, if these patients were monitored, since these are the preventable adverse events, they could have been helped. And this is not just cost, obviously saving lives. Other statistics, the Medicare expenses, 50% of it is for readmits that are preventable. And again, to help that, we want to have monitoring the patient so we can prevent those. Right now, patients that have cardiac situation usually identified on average like 15 minutes before. So if you have systems that can predict that, that could be obviously a huge, not only, again, cost saving, but more importantly, life saving. And I will show some clinical data later that this can be done. And again, in the hospital, as much as it's a burden for the nurses and inconvenience for the patients, at the same time, 96% of the time, there is nobody in the room to take a look at the patient. So a lot of bad things can happen. So obviously, early warning signs can be extremely useful for a number of these conditions. And I could go on and on. I just wanted to sort of give this as a motivation that this sort of monitoring is extremely useful for both saving lives and expenses. Another condition that is extremely sensitive to monitoring is sepsis. Sepsis is huge in terms of the damage that it does to the patients and to the costs and to the healthcare system. And this is one of those conditions that early detection is extremely important. Even every hour is important. So if we could have these sort of technologies in hospitals so they can be administered the right medicine and treatment, just a few hours, that makes a big difference. And on a regular spot check, that could be every 4, 6, or 8 hours, depending on hospital system and the protocol, this makes a huge difference. So that's probably one of the conditions that when you talk to hospitals, if you say you have any solution that can help in any way with sepsis, you get immediate attention. And one that this early detection is extremely sensitive. Every minute and hour do count. How can you monitor it? There are three things to look at, but the subtle changes in heart rate and breathing rate, it is an indication of an infection, which sepsis really is. So if you have every heartbeat and every breath looked at very carefully and with accuracy, you can make those detections. The other measurement is the temperature, which also is useful. So with these deterioration are preventable, why haven't things changed? And again, that goes to the thesis that obviously we need the technology and the clinical evidence. We had things that we had up to now, and some of those studies that I showed you, they were done with bulky, expensive devices. They were done for research purposes, and they were not a solution-oriented study, but what is the condition that needs to be done. Now, that's why we need to develop medical-grade devices we've been able to do now. And it's not just my company. There are a number of companies that are developing extremely accurate, yet small and affordable devices. But it has been hard, and part of that is not just the medical device development. You had to have the infrastructure, the Bluetooth, the low energy, internet, also ability to do the cloud computing and analytics and so forth that I will touch on. Let me also go back to show another aspect of these devices that is often overlooked. The intensive care unit, which is accurate, is not just cost of this that we're trying to avoid when we go to the general ward, but also inconvenient and uncomfortable. Now, that inconvenience and uncomfortable also causes patients to rest less. And again, has been a lot of studies that if a patient rests better, they recover faster. Later on, when I show you the clinical study for patients that were admitted at home, one of the leading reasons that the reason they recovered faster was because they could rest. There were not all these noises, the machines, the lights and so forth. So that's a very important aspect. And that's why I wanted to show this in a picture for you. The other part in the hospitals, obviously you want to be visited by technicians so you're not out there. But the other thing that some of you I'm sure know from visiting loved one in hospitals, that it seems like they often come in at the wrong time when somebody's studying, sleeping or resting. And again, going back to my previous thesis, that when you rest, you recover faster. And then other point is that with the devices that are out there, the telemetry devices and so forth, not only they're bulky, you can look at the data there, so it's been very useful for the nurses and technicians to warn doctors or nurses to help the patient, but at the same time, that data is almost temporary. You can look at it in the screen, but there have not been well documented into a EHR or EMR system, is almost disconnected. Most of these devices have like 96 hours of memory, not well connected to internet or other systems for post-analysis. Why can we make these changes now? And again, obviously the technology is the solution and the ecosystem that now we are enjoying. And as I started, the culture has evolved and people do not mind to be monitored. And in fact, what we have seen, people have legitimate concerns about privacy, but when you talk to the patient population, they're still concerned about their privacy, but a lot more than that, they're concerned about getting their data to their doctors as soon as possible so they do not deteriorate, or if help needs to be sent, is sent immediately. How has this technology evolved? We have four components I touched on. One is obviously cloud analytics. We can get this data and not just run one computer on it, but as many as you essentially need. If you're on Azure or in IBM, Watson, or Amazon, AWS, essentially you can get as much computing system as you need as you pay for it. And no one wants to sort of shortchange you when you're analyzing healthcare data. Connectivity, very important. One of the things that we are trying to do, and other people, that this is not just in hospital. So when patient is discharged, this continuum of care continues. So obviously good cellular connections, LTE and whatnot. The third one of the things that we make in our company, we make these biosensors. I'm holding one and I'll be glad to show you later on. They're very small, very flexible, but at the same time, they're as accurate as devices that are the size of a table for measuring your breathing rate, heart rate, ECG, and so forth in the hospital. These devices enjoy the same standard of FDA and regulatory clearances, and obviously can be relied on to make medical determinations. Last but not least, obviously artificial intelligence and more analyzing of these data, which is very, very important for some of the conditions that I talk about in a few minutes, such as heart failure and very, very subtle changes need to be calculated and looked at. Again, on the culture, I go a little faster, I'm sorry. We all have busy lifestyle, but at the same time, we're very happy to be on using mobile devices. But the change that we really seeing now, this last year and 2018, that hospital is not viewed as the best place to be. A lot of people in the healthcare, a lot of us knew that hospital in a way is a dangerous place, that other than proximity to doctors and great caregivers, which is great when you're sick, there is also opportunity to catch other diseases. You don't rest well, you don't sleep well, and so forth. And that is becoming more widely known. And in fact, patients that clinical study I will talk to you about later on, they did in the random study, most of the people wanted to be on the home side rather than the hospital side for the clinical study to have meaningful comparison. Let me just talk a little bit one of the clinical studies that we did. And again, this is showing one of the things that is only can be done by continuous monitoring. When we developed our products, we wanted to make sure people can use these things easily at home, that you don't need a doctor or a nurse to help you out. So we did a study of 2 months. So we had 50, 60 volunteers, and they took these home, showered with them, you know, did whatever they usually do, and we collected all that data for FDA submission. But one of the interesting things that happened was that one of the patients actually had a heart rhythm issue. If you see the bottom graph, there are some missing heart rate pulses. And if you look at the data, that happened very, very infrequently. So obviously our chief medical officer sent that patient to cardiologist, and it turned out that she just needed a simple a pacemaker to resolve her condition. Again, coming back to the case that you really need continuous monitoring to come up with some of these diagnoses. Let me talk a little bit more detail about one of the other clinical studies that was done with our device with a third-party analytics company called PhysIQ in Chicago. They did a very large study at the VA. The paper that was published was based only on 100 patients, but that's obviously still statistically significant. And this paper was published in American College of Cardiology and showing very, very promising results for the heart failure patients. This is the sort of study that I was talking about that they're coming out, and they're going to be the catalyst for wide acceptance of these type of devices. For this study, they again had to measure every beat every day to come up with these subtle changes. And what they essentially found out is that you could predict a heart failure condition that a patient is in the wrong trajectory about 6 days in advance. And for those of you who practice in medicine or know more about heart failure, when it's 6 days in advance, sometimes it's just a change of diet and moving, patient walking more, or things of that nature, diet and so forth, that can help you prevent this type of things. You don't need to be admitted to the hospital. So this was a very, very big study for both VA and also for our partner, because it had indisputable evidence that if you can have accurate measurements, but it has to be continuous, and over time, you can make this sort of prediction. Again, I go through this quickly because I think I talked about it enough. You have to have the continuous time to tell the whole story, and also the fact that you have the continuous monitoring of vital signs in presence of activity, that is also very, very important in the terms of the analytics. So now it is viable to have these type of solutions. Let me move to hospitals, and I have two cases of using these sort of devices in hospitals. The first case is, let me just show you the chart. This is probably better. Essentially, the data goes from the biosensor to a relay, which we make something that is very dedicated for hospital use. And the data goes to the nurse, but also goes to the cloud for aggregating this data, analyzing it, and a command center, so somebody at the hospital or a team can watch the entire hospital systems. So that's sort of the architecture, but let me just jump to the, and this is sort of how it looks. The upper right picture is looking at a single patient, and the bottom right is when you're looking at a whole bunch of patients, and it has all these analytics to see which patient to look at, which one has an alert, and that sort of stuff. All of this has to be FDA cleared, go through quality system, and so on and so forth. But let me just rush this through in interest of time to talk about the results. Patient experience, obviously, for the cardiac patients is so different with a Holter monitor versus something that we have there. For sleep analysis, again, the same type of thing. Once you have all this data, you can do analytics to do sleep analysis as good as capnography and the picture in the left. Again, one of the two studies that I wanted to emphasize more, this was done at Brigham and Women's Hospital in Boston. Dr. Levine has a video on YouTube if you want to look at it. He's a professor of medicine at Harvard Medical School, but also is the leader in this hospital-to-home type of program that they're doing. In this case, this is the published results. There is a much bigger study with hundreds of patients that is going to be published later, but this is what I can share with you. And again, on this, when they did the biosensor and randomly admitted some patients to home for mid-acuity, they saw enormous saving in cost, but more than that, they also saw fewer readmission for the patients who went home. They recovered faster, and they all obviously did not ever catch some other infection or anything like that. They were more active, they were more happy. There is some payers, the measure of satisfaction of payer has an influence on how much the hospital gets paid. So that's obviously was something that was appreciated for by them. And since we measure activity, we could also see that they are more up and so forth. So let me go to another hospital system that we had the privilege to work with. And that's the Mercy Hospital System in St. Louis. They are so committed to this sort of technology, they built that building on upper right, which is the Mercy Virtual. That's a hospital with no patient in it, but they have ability to look at thousands of patients with the technology that they have, and we have the small part of giving them the biosensor to look at their entire hospital, thousands of people that are in the hospitals, and monitor them continuously, and they get, they have shown better care at lower cost. And I let their officers give maybe the presentation in the next opportunity. One other thing that we see is that the hospitals are also becoming very expensive themselves to build. The cost of a hospital bed is becoming $1 to $1.5 million to build. So what you want to do is that you want to have the hospital as the sort of the center of the care, but push the care outside. And that's what they've done in Boston. Their activity is similar to that in California by leading teaching hospitals. So that way, we can essentially have hospitals that kind of move out and be able to give patient care outside the hospital. And again, this sort of technology is required to get the data from the patient, but analytics experts, doctors, and so forth are in the hospital. Which brings us back to those numbers that we talked about, that with this sort of technology, not only we save the patients, maybe the number of hospitals over time go down, and the length of stay and the significant costs associated with that. Same thing for the readmissions, for the patients in Medicare, and so on and so forth. So this technology really has the capability, now that we have clear medical evidence by leading institutions and very carefully published results, that I'm very optimistic that this gets picked up by more and more hospitals for 2018. We are sort of a year for the tipping point, and this technology, more than anything else, will save lives, improve patient experience. When we were looking for volunteers in hospitals, there was usually more people who wanted to be on the biosensor than the ones who did not want to be monitored, because as you know, you have to have two groups to do the clinical comparison. Clinicians are also very happy. This is not the type of technology they look at as they're replacing doctors or nurses. It's essentially helping doctors and nurses to do what they like to do, which is giving care to patients rather than measuring their pulses or looking at their ECG or things of that nature. So we essentially think that with this sort of technology, not only you can do that in hospitals, but you can monitor patients anytime, anywhere, which leads to post-discharge and obviously extending the hospitals to the neighboring communities. So thank you very much, and thank you for your attention.
Nersi, I'm really, really pleased that you're here with us today. As I said in my introduction, I can't think of anything more contemporary and on-trend in medical devices right now than this combination of IoT and miniature and immediate and feedback. There's no, as I understand it, there's no standard yet. You have a number of competitors, if I'm not mistaken. How do you compare? And are we going to look at it like a Sony versus Beta situation, where one of the kind of formulations is going to win versus the other? Is there a risk there for someone to bet on you, for example, versus another standard?
It is not as much of a standard fight that which way you want to do things, because it's everybody really is going to provide an end-to-end solution, like we provide the cloud, the biosensor, the connectivity, and so forth. And other people are probably going to be doing the same. So this is going to be like Medtronic, Western Boston Sci versus St. Jude. You know, it's who has better overall technology. We are a long way from a day that you buy the biosensor from this company and the cloud from the other company and so forth. And on top of that, the regulatory regime, right now it is that you have to submit the entire system to get approval.
So is it rare that a hospital will be your customer, but rather you have a strategic that you work with and you help them bundle their product offering? Is that more likely the way it works for your business?
Yes. That is one of the business models that is working.
Okay, actually. I know there are a couple questions in the audience.
I'm Walt McClay. I've got an interest in wearable devices. I'm curious what challenges you had in developing the wearable device, and what was the main challenge, and how long it took to develop?
Well, thank you for the question. It took us 5 years to develop this device. And one of the challenges that one of the speakers that spoke this afternoon, our friends at 3M, the adhesive is always a challenge to get it exactly right. But accuracy is probably the most important challenge. These devices are small, and we had also a speaker about dangers of miniaturization. The tolerances have to be higher, the algorithms have to have more bets and more accuracy. But I think those were the two, being accurate and yet small, and adhesion, and all of those that issues that you have with a device that is on your chest.
Hi, I'm Hitesh Mehta. A great talk. Just wondering, you have the system for the hospital, so could I buy for my parent and monitor them and say, oh, you're living like 6,000 miles away, so I can know what's going on and say, okay, you got to go to the doctor because something is not right, and help them out. Is that a possibility?
Well, technologically it's possible. When you have a patient wearing one of these, in fact, we've had cases that the consulting expert is somebody at Cambridge University. But as far as putting medical devices outside the country and so forth, there are regulatory and other restrictions.
Yes, great talk. Just a quick question. The data seems to be potentially overwhelming if you have to keep all the data for liability or other reasons, and how much human interaction is required, or can the algorithms spot the anomalies so that a nurse or someone doesn't have to look at all the data?
Thank you. Very, very good question. What we have done is that we really looked at these things from the current standard of care, the telemetry machines. So we have simple thresholdings for various measurements, which the nurse or the doctor orders that. Some of those very subtle things, like the heart failure prediction and so forth, those were done so essentially by experts. And those were done in clinical study. They have not been done on a live patients yet, because we need to get regulatory approval for prediction part of the algorithms.
Nersi, this kind of dovetails on Nitesh's question. It sounds as though almost everything you're focusing on now, at least from a strategic, all the things you could be working on perspective, is the hospital level of monitoring. And there are so many consumer level wrists and body suits and other things. Do you think that sensor technology, the kind that you specialize in, will find a consumer application, or is that strategically off plan for you?
You know, it could in one day, but right now we almost even speak different languages, because, you know, you're measuring the number of steps. I measure the number of steps, like versus some of the consumer products. But the standard of quality system is so different. We have to worry about a patient that is sick and is walking like this, which means a lot of more testing and so forth. Whereas for a pedometer, you know, it's for healthy people, they want to know if they do the 10,000 steps or not. Mm-hmm. So even with simple things like number of steps, the approach is so different. The emphasis on accuracy is so important. And I also find it that if somebody is perfectly healthy, like we wear it for our own, you know, studying and so forth, we don't find this much useful, to be honest with you, on a perfectly good engineer. We just gather the data for analysis, but they rather use their Fitbit for their jog in the morning anyways.
Mm-hmm. Okay.